We are taking chapter number 2, which is forest and wildlife resources. Forest and wildlife resources of India, what is happening to it, what we can do to save them, and what is the present scenario. The main thing which comes when we talk about anything related to forest and wildlife is the biodiversity. So what is this biodiversity? This term refers to diverse life forms existing in nature. That is, we have bio. Anything what we study in bio, that is the plants and the animals, the species. So anything related to this is bio. And when we say diversity, that means different forms. So different forms of biology, different forms of plants and animals, maybe of any type, any size. So it refers to diverse life form existing in our nature. So the various species, different types of species of plants and animals, we'll call them flora and fauna. These plants and animals, which are quite interrelated, interdependent on each other, this constitute the biological diversity. In short, we call it as biodiversity. India is home to nearly 8% of world's biodiversity. 8% we have. India has 81,000 species of fauna and 47,000 of flora. Now this flora, you can remember it by the word flower. So flower, it comes from plants. So you can say that plants, all type of plants, big, small trees, all this comes under flora. And when it comes to fauna, you see this A is for animal. You may remember like this. For all the animals we have, fauna words used. So 81,000 species of fauna we have. A large number of animals and plant species in India, they are in endangered list. That means they are in danger. And India has about 22% of total area under forests. Half of its natural forests have been destroyed. Let me give you some pictures first. This is cheetah. This is pink-headed duck. Mountain quail. Forest-spotted owl. They all are in this list. So let me take you to the detail now that we have been talking about different types of microorganisms. It can be the animals can be from microorganisms to even bigger or the largest mammals like blue whales. So these things which we are talking even with the plants, they all constitute the biodiversity. And we just talked about biodiversity. So there is a very complex system how this flora and fauna, plants and animals, they are related. And please mind, you are also, we human beings are also the part of this biodiversity. We biodiversity, whatever we get, we breathe, we drink water, and the food we get from the soil, and all these constitutes biodiversity. Forests are the key player. Why they are key player? Because in ecological system, whatever you get, most of the things, the primary produce you get is from the forest. So again, coming back to biodiversity or biological diversity, this is just a short form. So it is immensely rich in wildlife and cultivated species, diverse in form and function, but closely interrelated, integrated in a system through multiple network of interdependency. So when different types of plants and animals, they are interrelated, we call them as biodiversity, along with everyone, everything in the nature. So let me come to the flora and fauna in India. So we are very rich in biodiversity. Around 8% of the total number of species in the world, that is around 1.6 million we have biodiversity. Then 81,000 species of fauna, 47,000 of flora, that is 47,000 of plant species and 81,000 of animal, different size and shapes of animals. In this 47,000 plant, 15,000 are ours, Indian, endemic or indigenous to Indian region. But there are certain estimates which are alarming. That is, 10% of India recorded wild flora and 20% of the mammals. They are in threatened list. They are in critical situation. They are on the verge of extinction. But some of them, which I just showed you, they are almost finished. Not only these birds or these animals, along with this, we have Madhuka insignis. This is a wild variety of Mahua. And Habardia heptaneuron. This is a species of a grass. So we are not only talking about animals, but the grass, the different type of plant species, they are also finished. 79, see these, we are talking about the large animals, 79 species of mammals, 45 of birds, 15 of reptiles, and 3 of amphibians, they are threatened. 1500 plant species endangered. Flowering plants, vertebrate animals, they have recently become extinct. And it's quite a rate which is quite faster than we can expect. But what we are doing? This is a picture of a forest with fire. It may be man-made. But this we have to understand that these forests are vanishing. That is, deforestation we are doing. The forest cover in the country is estimated at 6,37,293 square kilometers. What is the percentage? It is 19.39% of total geographical area. Total geographical area, but you have to understand that this is the 1999 report, right? In 1960-61, it was 18%. Then in 2008 to 2009, it was 22%. So this is the data of 1999. So 19.39% of the Indian region is covered by forest. And how much we need? At least 33% we want. And in this, dense forests are very, very closely, the trees are very close. These are 11.48. When the trees are sparse, they are 7.76%. And the mangrove, the sea, where land and sea meet, there are areas we have mangrove. These are around 0.15%. But we have seen there is an increment of forest cover, that is around 10,098 square kilometer has increased. But because people are actually know the problem and they are planting it. But still, we need how much? 33%, and it is way less than what we are expecting. Now, learning about flora and fauna or the species, different species, will be very difficult if we don't categorize them. So we need to categorize them. So there is IUCN. There is IUCN. So we have to classify these species. So IUCN, you have to understand the full form of IUCN. This is International Conservation of Nature. This is International Union of Conservation of this N comes twice. So this is means this not come twice, but it has the meaning of N twice. So one N is for, this N is again used for the nature, and this N is again used for the natural resources. So let me go it to you again. IUCN means International Union of Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources. So they have classified. In terms of classification, we have first as the normal species. Now these species, you will find it everywhere. For example, cattle, rodents, you will find it everywhere. I can go up to say the sal and pine, these are the trees, you'll find everywhere. When it comes to endangered species, you can see the name danger here. So it is endangered. This species is in danger. So they are in danger of extinction. That is, they are going to just finish off as their population is decreasing, fast dwindling. They are, you can say, these are the species which are having a danger of extinction. Maybe because the living condition for them is not suitable, or we are doing something to make them extinction, maybe hunting, etc. So the example is black buck. I'll show you all the pictures, but black buck, Indian wild ass, Indian rhino, lion, crocodile. These are in endangered species. Coming to vulnerable species. Vulnerable means you take any animal which cannot move faster, like tortoise. Now the tortoise cannot move faster, but the cap on its back is very precious. So it is vulnerable. The population has decreased to the level of being coming into endangered if you don't take care of them. For example, Asiatic elephant, blue sheep, Gangetic dolphins. These are all vulnerable species. Coming to rare species, and they are in very small number, and if you're not taking care of them, they may go to endangered species or vulnerable species. Like hornbill, Himalayan brown bear, wild Asiatic buffalo, desert fox. These are rare species. Coming to endemic species, Deshaj, Indian, or only found in here. The species, or they are found only in a particular region. These are called endemic species. So the species that are found only in a particular region and they are isolated by natural barriers are called endemic species. For example, if you go to Andaman Nicobar Island, you'll find teal in only Andaman, pigeon in only Nicobar. So pigeon, that is why the name is Nicobar pigeon. You'll not find this pigeon anywhere else. Same is for the teal. You'll not find it anywhere else than Andaman. Then you all have a wild pig. You'll only find it in Andaman Islands. Then we come to extinct species. Those who have left us. They've already gone. So the species no longer exist on this earth. Asiatic cheetah, pink head duck. I showed you the picture. These are almost extinct. But let me take you again to all these because these are very important. So we have cattle and rodents, normal species. Endangered species, these are endangered species. We have the black buck, you know, a star who is facing charges against killing the black buck. Then we have Indian wild ass. Then we have blue sheep. This is blue. Let me come to the Indian wild ass. Blue sheep is in vulnerable species. So we have this. I'm going back to endangered species. Black buck, Indian wild ass. Then we have the Indian rhino. Then we have the lion, the crocodile. All these are endangered species. Vulnerable species, Asiatic elephant. We have Asiatic elephant. Then we have this blue sheep. Then this is the Gangetic dolphin. Rare species coming to hornbill. Then we have this Himalayan brown bear. Then we have the wild Asiatic buffalo, this one, and the desert fox. These are rare species. And coming to the endemic species, see, all these are the endemic species. You will only find them like the Andaman teal, or this one, that is the Nicobar pigeon, Andaman wild pig. This is Andaman wild pig. You won't find it anywhere else. And these two, pink-headed duck and cheetah, they are finished. So let me show you some more pictures, because it is very important to understand through picture that what all are being finished. For example, these are the Nicobar, these megpods, they are already finished. These all what we see, this is used for making mats, baskets, and this is also a simple plant, and this was having the medicinal properties. They are also of extinct, rare and endangered species. Now coming to the Asiatic cheetah, we have to really talk about them. See, Asiatic cheetah, they are world's fastest land mammal. They could run up to a speed of 112 km an hour. See, a cheetah or an animal is so fast. It was declared extinct in 1952 in India. In India, 1952, already extinct. It was mainly found in Asia and Africa. And how do you differentiate between a cheetah and a leopard? Cheetah has this line, you see. There is a distinguishing mark on, these are long teardrop shaped. These are teardrop shaped lines on each side of the nose from the corner of its eye to its mouth. Cheetah, you can find, you know, earlier 20th century in Asia and Africa, they were there. But they are almost finished. And in India, they have already gone by 1952. So what are the reasons? No, you need to understand the reason why this is happening. See, we are changing things. We are transforming the nature according to us. That is, you see, wood, bark, leaves, rubber, medicines, dyes, food, fuel, fodder, manure, all we get from where? From the nature. So what are we doing? Maybe, you know, wantedly or unwantedly, we are depleting the forest and wildlife because we are using them. We are using the resources, right? And apart from this, it started all from colonial rule, because at the colonial rule, there was an expansion. Railway was expanded, agriculture was expanded, more commercial things were done, scientific forestry was done, and mining, that is taking out of the ores, minerals from the ground. This was mining activities. And this, again, you know, after the independence, this carried on. So in just 30 years, 1915 to 1980, according to FSI, that is Forest Survey of India, 26,200 of the forest was converted into agriculture land. You see, when you convert the forest into agriculture land, you are benefited. But what about the forest? What about the flora and fauna? So in these 30 years, 26,200 of forest were converted into agriculture land. And there are certain ways also, you know, these were the things which we talked about. But there is something called shifting cultivation, where most of the people who are tribals, they follow it still. That is called Jhum. And they just slash and burn one place, go to other place. So they just cut trees and just they burn it. So this is also a kind of situation we need to deal with. So what are the causes of depletion of biodiversity? See, first is we are over-exploiting the natural resource for meeting human needs. And the question arises that human will need, it is not that human will not need the natural resources. We are dependent on it. We must use it. But there is an over-exploitation, that means overuse or unnecessary pressure on the natural resources by the humans. Then the hunting, because the skin and other produce of the animals, they are so precious and wanted also, demand is so much, that they are being hunted for their antlers and fur. The area of the agriculture is always increasing. So where from the area will come? It will come from the forest areas, that is the biodiversity area. Then the railway network or road network or any network of transport, it always causes harm to biodiversity. Mining. So what happens in mining? See, this is a place we mine, we dig up, and this is digging up. So we have started depleting or harming the biodiversity first of all. Then we take out our stuff, then we just move away. Every garbage and the remains are kept here. So first we cut the forest, destroy the biodiversity, then we dig a pit, a very large area of pit, then we just move away with all the garbage and the soil which we took out here. So what are you able to understand by this? So mining is also a major cause of depletion of biodiversity. Then what happens that the forestry is, if you don't do anything, the forest will come up by themselves. If it has to, you don't have to do anything. These are natural forests. But because of our needs, because of the human needs and for commercial and scientific forestry, what we do? We plant those trees which are beneficial to us, like teak monoculture in South India, cheer and pine plantation in Himalayas. So they have replaced, or actually we have replaced, the natural growing forest, which consisted of oak and rhododendron forest. So this is how, for commercial purpose, we are growing such things. We need to, we must. I'm not saying that we should not, but still, we are just depleting the other natural biodiversity, natural forest that would come up. Overgrazing. Now, in our rural community, always we have different kind of cattle, they graze. So it is not a problem. They have grasslands or grazing lands. But when we have overgrazing, when these cattle enter, they are just left, they just enter the forest, they enter the area, because there are so many cattle, so they just destroy that area and no plants would come up. That is the overgrazing. Then pollution, environmental pollution we are doing. May it be air pollution, may it be water or land, every kind of pollution we are responsible for. Then the projects, you know, a country developing economy is always regarded or indicated as making or building or executing infrastructural projects, big projects like the Narmada Sagar project in Madhya Pradesh. It has already submerged a large area under forest. So this was biodiversity, and because of this project, we have already submerged a large area. Forest fire, wildfire. Sometimes the fire catches by itself because of the scorching heat of the sun. Sometimes it's human made. And if the fire starts in a jungle or a forest, then it will end everything. Not even the plants, trees, but all the microorganisms or the mammals living there. So let me go into the details so I can just show you what we discussed. As we said, large scale projects, and these large scale development projects have contributed for the loss of forest. For river valley projects, since 1951, we have already cleared 5,000 square kilometer. We just talked about Narmada Sagar project, 40,000 hectares of forest already gone. Mining is also responsible. I'll give you an example. Baksa Tiger Reserve in West Bengal. Why it is threatened? It is threatened because there is dolomite mining going on there. Dolomite mining. So this is, some pictures that tribal girls, they are using bamboo saplings in a nursery at Mohali near Silent Valley. Some of the women, tribal women, they, take this forest produce and they sell it. This is how they earn their livelihood. And these are all the leaf, they are already being shedded by the tree. So they are taking this leaf litter collected by the women folk. So they are not so much responsible for harming that many people would argue. That is, grazing and fuel wood collection is the major cost of forest depletion. Some foresters and environmentalists, they argue that this is the main cause. But if you see, is this the main cause? We don't think so. The major cause is what we just discussed. Right? Because, even if you see someone taking the wood or for fuel purpose, he is not going to take all of the tree. He is going to only take some which is already there in the ground. I'll show you a picture of Himalayan yew. And it was very important as far as medicinal purpose is concerned. And this is the Himalayan yew. And this is in trouble, almost finished. Then, the habitat destruction. All of the things which we are talking is what we are been doing. The habitat, natural habitat in which the flora and fauna would flourish, we are being destructing it. Hunting is a main problem. Poaching, over-exploitation, over-usage, the pollution we are creating, the poisoning, that is the chemical and all the things which we are just ruthlessly sending it in the biodiversity area and dumping it. Forest fires, these are all the factors. And that is why India's biodiversity is declining. So this is a question. The answer is, why is India's biodiversity declining? This is because of habitat destruction, hunting, poaching, over-exploitation, environmental pollution and poisoning. These are the cause. And there is one more thing. People say that in the developing economy or in the jansankhya or the population, where the population density is quite high, people are overusing the resources. But this is not the case. Why? An average America is a developed country. So an average American person, he or she consumes 40 times more resources than the average Somalian. Somalia is a poor country. But still, America person is consuming the resources 40 times. So this is an uneven distribution or uneven consumption of the resources. Then the rich people. There are 5% rich people who are taking all the resources, maximum resources, and they are also not bothered about the responsibilities of revamping it or doing something for the biodiversity conservation. So we have rich people, 5% of them, they are causing more ecological damage than the others. Let me tell you one more thing, that over half of Indian natural forests, they are already gone. Half of this very alarming situation, half of Indian natural forests are already gone. One third of the wetlands drained out. Wetlands are those area where if there is a heavy rain or there is a situation of flood, this wetlands area acts as solving this purpose. So they just, you know, get wet or get water and they solve the situation. But one third of this has already drained out. 70% of its surface water bodies are already polluted. 70% water bodies polluted. 40% are of the mangrove trees wiped out. And why? This all has happened because we are doing it. We are hunting. We are doing trading. We are doing everything commercial. So we just depleted most of the things. So we just can't say that this destruction is a biological issue, whether it is a forest life or wildlife. It is not that. It is correlated or interrelated with the cultural diversity also. There are various communities in India and various other countries which are forest dependent. They get food, they get drink, medicine, culture, spirituality, everything depends on them, the forest. If you see, go to the poor people, then you see that they are mainly the women. They are responsible for fuel, fodder, water. On all the needs, they depend on these forests. Once they are depleted, they have to walk for say 10 kilometers. This causes serious health problem for the women. And this has a direct or you can say indirect impact on their health. Then whatever we do, when the flood comes, when the drought comes, who are going to suffer? Have you seen any 5% of the Indian community richest people are suffering? No, only the poor people will suffer. Only the poor people will suffer. So now it becomes very important, very, very important for conservation of forest and wildlife. It's very important now. That is, we need to conserve the forest and wildlife. Because all the support system, water, air and soil, there has to be some genetic diversity of plants and animals. That is, when the different types of plants and animals, and this is the theory in biology also, that the genetical combination, different combination will make the next species more adaptable and livable for the next generation. So this is not happening. This is not happening. We need different type of crop varieties. So all this situation, people, you know, everyone is not just, you know, wasting things or depleting biodiversity, but the government is also doing something. When the conservationalists and all other people, they wanted and they demanded in 1960s and 1970s, there was an act in 1972 which was implemented, and this was called as Indian Wildlife Protection Act. Again, in 1972, an act which is called as Indian Wildlife Protection Act was implemented. And all these protected species list was being published. This is done why? Because there has to be a law. There has to be an act by the government to ban hunting, to give legal status or protection to their habitats, the places where live. We need to restrict trade of wildlife through the act, through the kanun, through the law. So the government and the state and everyone has established various national parks, wildlife sanctuaries. These are only the places where there is financial and technical support by the government. And there are certain projects also which government has announced, and specifically those animals which are endangered, including the tiger. So Indian Wildlife Act, this is an act for conservation of biodiversity of India, and it was passed in 1972, we just saw, and it contains a list of protected species in the country, and this bans on hunting was imposed through this law. and legal protection was provided to the habitats where these flora and fauna lives or flourish of endangered species. Then the restriction on any trade in wildlife, this comes under this act. And because of this act only, various national parks and wildlife sanctuaries were established throughout the country. Projects as Project Tiger, the Project Elephant, these are very specific to particular species. These were formulated, and this doesn't mean that only these are there. For everything, the act has something to offer. So let me tell you about the Project Tiger, but before that, I'll tell you that there are not only the tiger, but the one-horned rhinoceros, the Kashmir stag, or hangul we call them. There are three types of crocodiles we found: freshwater crocodile, then we have saltwater crocodile, then we have ghadiyals. Ghadiyals are only found in India. Ghadiyals are only found in India, a type of crocodile. Then we have Asiatic lion, and there are many others who are being, actually they are in the verge of extinction, and there is a lot of poaching and hunting going on. So the law will enforce that this will not happen again. And we have Indian elephant, black buck, that is Chinkara, the great Indian bustard, that is Godavan we call him, and the snow leopard. They have also been given full and partial legal protection against any kind of hunting and trade throughout the India. So this is very important as far as the 1972 Act is established, or it is being enacted. So we were talking about Project Tiger. This is a very interesting thing that it was initiated in 1973. And why it was initiated, that it came down to, more precise, 1827. The tigers were 55,000 and it came down to 1827. That means they are almost finished. They're almost finished. So the main reason for decline of the number of tigers are what? First of all, poaching, because the tiger skin is very expensive. Then, or people are demanding it. Shrinking habitat, the place where they live is very small now. They are not getting enough food. Depletion of the prey species, that is the food on which they prey, that is the animals on which they, or the animal they eat, they are not there. Human population is growing, so the area of human population is growing, their habitat and their places are shrinking. So there are 27, it is giving that 27, and this is the older number under this Project Tiger. But now in 2019, there are 50 tiger reserves, 50 tiger reserves presently. So this includes various important, we can mention them, like the Jim Corbett National Park in Uttarakhand, then Sundarbans National Park in West Bengal, then we have Bandhavgarh National Park in Madhya Pradesh, and Sariska Wildlife Sanctuary in Rajasthan, Manas Tiger Reserves in Assam, Periyar Tiger Reserve in Kerala. So let me just take you there so that we have just an idea that these are all the tiger reserves. We talked about this Corbett, we have Dudhwa, Sariska, Manas, and all these Periyars, all these are the tiger reserves, and these are mainly to reserve, to protect this very important species. Now we are not only focusing on a single species. Now the idea, that is the conservation projects, are focusing on the biodiversity. Means everything has to be there, everything from the smaller to the higher. So what happened, even the insects, very small insects, these are being conserved. So there was a notification under the Wildlife Act of 1980 and 1986. So there is already a law, 1972. Then there was a notification in 1980 and 1986. And this notification says that several hundred butterflies, moth, beetles, and one dragonfly, means this small, very, very small, you can say, wildlife also have been added to the protected species. In 1991, first time, the plants, very small plants, they are also being included. So for the first time, plants were also included to the list, starting with 6 species. So in 1991, it happened for the first time. Then coming to the areas, because it is always important to understand that we have so much scarcity, or these very important species are dying, like the ghadiyals you see here, ghadiyal on the brink. So there has to be a type and distribution of forest, because government has to do something. So they have to divide these forests according to their importance. So there is a distinction, or there is a differentiation or Vargikaran classification. Types of distribution of forest and wildlife resources has been done. So the forest department and other government departments, they if they are able to, or they are allowed to manage or own them in proper way, there has to be some categories. So government has decided certain categories. First is the reserve forest. So more than half of the total forest land has been declared reserve forest. If you see here, most of the area is the reserve forest. So what are these reserve forests? They are regarded as the most valuable as far as the conservation of forest and wildlife resources are concerned. Most valuable for their forest and wildlife resources. This is the conservation. So reserve forests are more than half of the total forest. Coming to the protected forest. One third of the total forest area is protected forest. Half is reserve forest, and one third of the forest are protected forest. And this has been declared by the forest department. And these forests are done what? Why? Because these protected forests, they have to be protected for any further depletion. They have already depleted. We can't afford further depletion. Coming to those which are not being classed, these are called unclassed forest. Unclassed forest. So these are the forest and wasteland which belong to the government also, and it can belong to some private people or communities. So this reserved and protect forest, we also call them as permanent forest estates. Permanent forest estates. These reserved and protected forests also called as permanent forest estates. Why? Because they are maintained for the purpose of producing timber and other forest produce. This is very important. They are permanent forest estates because they have a purpose of producing timber and other forest produce. And also for protection. Protective reason is already there. So Madhya Pradesh has the highest percentage of permanent forest. That is 75%. These permanent forests, that is reserved and protected forests, are 75%. If you go to Jammu Kashmir, Andhra Pradesh, Uttaranchal, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, West Bengal and Maharashtra, they have large percentages of what? This forest, reserve forests. If you go to Bihar, Haryana, Punjab, Himachal Pradesh, Odisha and Rajasthan, you will get most of these protected forests. And if you go to these northern states, that is these states, then you have most of the, you know, and also the Gujarat. So most of the place of Gujarat, northeastern states, they have high percentage of forests which are unclassed. That is, they are managed by local communities. So it comes to conservation. You can't, you know, just say that government is going to conserve it. We need, because this is an area, government is somewhere, you know, it makes decisions, planning decisions, policies. But for this area, there is a community living here. There is a community living inside also. So the government has to have a collaboration, or they have to have a participation of these communities also in order to get the proper result. So let me take you to some important results we have found. So when it comes to community and conservation, as I said, that communities also have to be included. I'll give you an example. In Sariska Tiger Reserve, Rajasthan, the villagers were the main key players. They fought against the mining by citing what is the Wildlife Protection Act. So they are protecting habitats. There are certain groups which are actually rejecting government also. For example, in Alwar district of Rajasthan, the 12,000 hectare of forest has been declared as Bhairav Dev Dhaka Sanctuary. And the villagers, they have their own rules and regulation. They would not allow any hunting, any kind of wildlife encroachments. So then we have the Chipko Andolan. We have seen about the people who are grabbing the trees when they are being cut ruthlessly. So this is Chipko Andolan. And this success of this Chipko Andolan, they have actually said, or they have surfaced the idea of communities also being involved, which was quite successful. Then we have a Beej Bachao Andolan in Uttarakhand and in Tihri. Tihri is in Uttarakhand. And Navadanya. Navadanya means nine seeds. So this Beej Bachao Andolan and Navadanya, they have also given They have shown that the adequate level of diversified crop, now dhanya means dhane, bees, seeds, crop production without the use of synthetic chemicals. So there are things going on and the people are also doing it, communities are also doing it. So India, we have Joint Forest Management, JFM. And this is very good example where joint means the communities and the government, they start doing the things together. And this started in Odisha. This program, very important to understand, this is asked in the question, that this joint forest management, it started in 1988 in Odisha. The first resolution for joint India management was passed here. So now the JFM depends or allows the formation of local village institution, and that are going to take the things in their hand and they are going to protect the activities. And in return, the government will also do something. The members of these communities which are protecting here, they are getting benefit, like they are getting non-timber forest produced, they may get it, and also share in the timber harvested by the successful protection. So there is a win-win situation. Government also does something and the people who are protecting also get something. So here, what is the thing is, there is a very critical situation we are facing. And this critical situation, we want to make the community also involved so that the conservation can be done. Now let me take you to the sacred groves. That is, they are form of nature worships, because in Indian culture and tradition, we worship everything. So they are a form of natural worship practiced by the tribal people of India. So tribe considered forest as gods and goddesses and preserved them in their pristine form, that is their actual form. Any human interference is actually banned in these sacred groves, or you can say forests. So tribe, region and reserve tree and animal, if you take the table of that, the Mundas and Santhals in Chota Nagpur Plateau, they treat Mahua and Kadamba trees as very precious and they worship them. The Bishnoi tribe in Rajasthan, they take care of black buck, Nilgai, etc. Then the tribes of Orissa and Bihar, you will see tamarind and mango trees, they are being worshipped. So Gautam Buddha said very important thing, that when you come here to cut the tree is so kind, it has so benevolence that it will give the shade to even the person who is cutting it, the axeman who came to destroy it. This is what Gautam Buddha has said, and there is a great message in what he said. So this is all about this chapter. Thank you so much and take care of yourself.